All right, welcome and thanks for joining me. My name is Chirag Dave. I'm a Senior Database Specialist Solution Architect here at AWS. And today we'll be talking to you about what's new in Amazon RDS for Postgres. So for starter, Amazon Relational Database Service or Amazon RDS for Postgres makes it easy to set up, operate, and scale fully managed Postgres in the cloud. And in today's talk, we'll talk about some of the key innovation we have done in the recent past and some of the improvement in the recent version of Postgres. So to get started, we're going to talk about multi-AZ with two readable standby. There were some enhancement to multi-AZ with two readable standby. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about some of the improvement around scalability and upgrades that we've done. New instance type in RDS we have added. Then we'll talk about trusted language extension and I have a small demo to talk about that. And then last but not least, we're going to talk about some of the new capabilities that come with Postgres 15. All right, to get started, I want to talk about multi-AZ with two readable standby. So notable addition in multi-AZ with two readable standby is that now we support an inbound replication support, meaning that if you have a multi-AZ with this one standby, you can replicate data to a Amazon RDS for multi-AZ with two readable standby. And next is the snapshot restore, meaning that if you have multi-AZ with two readable standby, you can take a snapshot of it and restore it onto a single AZ cluster or multi-AZ with this one standby. In order to explain all of that, let's go back and understand what are the two this options when it comes to multi-AZ. So let's compare the two multi-AZ options that are available in Amazon RDS for Postgres. So the first one is we call it with one standby. As you can see in the picture here, we have a primary database, which is attached with an EBS storage. And then we create another standby database in a secondary AZ, which is also attached with its own EBS. And if you look at the write path, as you write to your primary database, the data gets flowed into the EBS in the primary region. Then it flows to the secondary region. Once we get acknowledgement from the secondary region, it gets acknowledged back to the application. So there are like four steps in acknowledging it. One important thing here is that every time you write the data in the primary region, it's synchronously replicated. So this is how we achieve higher durability and high availability. In case your primary database fails over, the standby gets promoted as the writer instance. And this works great. Now in contrast, the two readable standby always comes with three instances. But if you notice here, so one of the instances is a writer instance, and the other two instances are readable instance. And the write path in the two readable standby is you write to a primary instance, and then the data flows to both the reader nodes. And once we get the acknowledgement from either of these reader, the application gets the acknowledgement. So if you look at the write path of the one standby and the two standby and the two standby, it's a two-step process here. So the two standby is a great option if you're looking for a faster transaction commit. And more importantly, those two readable standby are available for any read-only workload. So if you want to scale your reads, you can use these two nodes to read from. In addition, we also get automatic failover in case a primary instance were to go down. One of the reader node will become the writer, and typically the failover is within 35 seconds. So now all is great. So what's changed? Well, what has changed is, assume in your production you're running one standby instance, and now you want to switch to two readable standby. The new inbound replication will make things very easy for you. So what you can do is you can create a sort of a replica cluster from your one standby instance. So if you do an inbound replication from your one standby to two readable standby, and once it's all caught up, you can switch over to two readable standby. So from the second improvement that we have done is the snapshot restore. So assuming you're already running on two readable standby, and for example, if you want to restore this database for your dev or QA work, where you do not need two readable standby, you can take a snapshot of two readable standby and restore it to a single instance or a RDS with multi-AZ with one standby. So that's another option that's available to you. From the GUI perspective, this is how it would look like. Let's say if you're running a demo instance, which is your single AZ or multi-AZ with one readable standby, you can create a multi-AZ DB replica cluster off that. And then once it's caught up, you can always cut over to this new cluster. So it provides you an easy way to switch from a multi-AZ with a single standby to two readable standby. If you're using CLI, there's a new options available to you, as you can see on your screen. It's called replication source identity. So when you create a 3AZ cluster, 3AZ DB cluster with two readable standby, you can use this to replicate data from your multi-AZ DB instance. The next set of improvement that we have done is around the scalability and upgrades. So one of the key important change that we have done is around the major version upgrade. So major version in Postgres is typically, we release and a community release major version about every year, and we do the same. And when we do a major version upgrade, there is, if you're doing an in-place upgrade, there is a some sort of a downtime incurred along with the major version upgrade. And some of the improvement we have done in recent past, we have seen up to 50% faster upgrade. Essentially, we have done, because it's a managed service, we run through a lot of pre-checks. And some of the optimization we have done is we have optimized some of these pre-checks. And at times, we have tried to make these pre-checks online and that reducing your downtime. The next improvement we have done is to support increase in the storage size when you create a replica. So this is great when your primary instance or a snapshots are near maximum allocated storage capacity. Let's say your storage capacity is 100 gig and your snapshot is running out of that. When you create additional replica or when you restore from the snapshot, you can specify or modify the storage size. So that's another improvement that is available to you from the scalability perspective. And last but not least, we have added the 3x or 3x more read capacity for your RDS instances. And here it works. So I talked about a single standby. We talked about a couple slides back. So you have a primary instance and you have a standby instance. And standby instance is really, as the name suggests, it's a standby. You cannot really read from it. However, you can add more reader instance to it. So you could add now up to 15 reader. It used to be 5. Now you can add up to 15 reader nodes off your primary database. And that makes your read capacity 3x more than what you had. Now, switching gear, let's talk about some of the new instance type we've added. So one of the new instance type is X2IEDN. X2IEDN is really designed for really high read intensive and high throughput workload, like your SAP HANA kind of workload. And it is a third generation of your Intel Xeon scalable processors, which provides you 4x memory than your R6i. So you can see that it gives you a maximum of 4 TB of RAM and up to 100 gigs of network throughput. So it's really designed for those high read intensive and high throughput workload, and is available on Postgres versions 13.7 and higher or 14.5 and higher. So now let's talk about Trusted Language Extension or TLE. So Postgres has become a preferred open source relational database for many of the enterprise and startup because of its extensible nature. What I really mean by that is, as a developer, you can extend the functionality of Postgres by writing extension with a preferred language of yours. We today currently support more than 85 Postgres extensions, such as PG Audit, PostGIS, PG Partment, and so on and so forth. But what in this particular extension or this trusted language extension, what we are providing you is an open source development kit or a framework which allows you to write your own extension, which are performant, and you can securely run on a managed services. So now a builder can build their own extension, and then the customer chooses the extension, which application they require, and now DBA can then install and manage those TLE extensions. So TLE, as the name suggests, is a trusted language extension. So it allows you to write extension in a trusted language. And the languages we support today are JavaScript, Perl, and PLPGSQL. And so the attribute of these trusted language is it restricts direct access to the file system, and it prevents unwanted privilege escalation. So this extension enforces Postgres to use this trusted language, and it provides you the safe access to the Postgres internals. Because we are writing this using JavaScript or Perl or PLPGSQL, it supports a language that have a C-like performance, and it removes any need to be an expert in programming in C, for example. It also gives you the flexibility. It builds and use extension. You can build and use extension on your time, and it reduces your DBA certification burden. So let me show you a quick demo of how to get started with PGTLE. Now, there's a number of ways you can do it. There are extensions that are available in RDS, but let's say if there's a third-party extension available and you want to install with PGTLE, that's what the demo is going to be about. Or you want to write your own extension, you can certainly write your own extension in a similar manner. So let's take a quick demo here. So here what I have is I have my Postgres instance 15. And the very first thing you need to do is you need to modify your parameter group and update your shared preload library with PGTLE. That's an extension we'll be installing. So first you need to install the extension and enable the framework to write or enable other extensions. So once you enable PGTLE in the shared preload library, you'll have to restart. So that's a safety feature that before you enable this, you'll have to restart once to enable the PGTLE. But once the PGTLE is installed and you grant proper privileges, you can start using PGTLE. So that's what I've done. I've restarted. And once the restart happens, the PGTLE is enabled now. So now, if you can see on my screen, if I do a show shared preload library, you can see the PGTLE is available now. And now, creating extension is simple as create extension PGTLE. And at this point, I can see under my list of extension, my PGTLE is enabled. So now this has opened up my gateway to create more extension. The last thing I want to do is I want to grant a proper privileges. So I'm allowing a Postgres, my master user, a write privileges to create more extension. Next thing what we do is, let's say if you have a third-party extension, which is an open source, in this case, MVStats that you want to install. I'm going to check this out, and I'm going to show you a friendly script that is available, part of the PGTLE project, as to how do you install a third-party extension. So in this case, what I'm doing is under the PGTLE project, if you check it out, again, like I said, it's an open source project. You have a bash script which you can use. And what I'm trying to do here is I'm saying, install me this extension, PGMVE, and it will be installed on my Postgres instance on the path that I've given here. Now let's go and verify that. We can certainly verify that by using similar function, similar action called action list, and you can see which functions or the which extensions been installed, and I can see that MVStat of a given version is already installed. If you log into Postgres, there is a special schema that gets created called PGTLE. You can certainly look into that, and you have a set of functions available to you. And one of the functions is to show you the available extension. And if you run the available extension, you see the similar output of the extension we just installed, which in this case is the MVStats. So I just showed you how you can take a third-party extension and with PGTLE framework, install that extension on an RDS database. All right, switching gears. Next, we're going to talk about some of the improvement that we have done on Postgres 15. So Postgres 15 was launched from the community sometime late last year. And the highlights are there was significant work done on simplifying the developer experience. There are more space-saving options in the backup and archive that are gone. There's been more flexibility with logical replication, and there are general improvement to help with your daily tasks. What I like to talk about is the improvement in in-memory sort performance. So if you have an application where you're running a lot of aggregates, like order by or group by, or you're doing a merge join, which requires a sorting, or you're running a distinct query, there's a significant improvement that you can see in the sort performance in Postgres 15. One of my favorite feature is a merge command. So it's a merge is a new command that was added in Postgres 15, which allows you to merge two tables based on insert, update, or delete. And I have a very short demo to follow. The next one, one of my favorite one again, is the LZ4 and ZSTD write ahead log compression. So this is to improve the performance of your archiving. So if you compress your write ahead log with a newer compression like LZ4 and ZSTD. The default is PGLZ, but now you can use LZ4 and ZSTD. And last but not least, there was improvement around logical replications. So Postgres has been constantly adding new functionality with logical replication since version 10. And in Postgres 15 now, one of the key improvement is around the row and the column filtering. So if you're logically replicating, let's say a table where you wanna ignore certain column, you can certainly do that. Or if you wanna restrict certain rows to get replicated, you can do that. So now you have a built-in capability to filter out certain columns and rows. And now to conclude, I have a very short demo to show you the merge command, where I have a couple of tables and I'm gonna show you how merge command can be used to merge the table data between these two. So here we go. What I have here is I have a customer table here. So let's get started here. So we have a customer account table, and then I have a recent transactions. So anytime the recent transaction happens in the table, I want to get it reflected on the customer account table. So let's quickly look at it. So I have a customer account table with a bunch of rows, and you can see customer ID from 1 to 9, and same with the recent transaction. Great. Now let's say if there is some recent transaction that happens, and now I want to update the record in the customer account, how I'm going to do it. So let me go ahead and insert a new entry in the customer transaction table. So I'm inserting a new customer, let's say 10, which was not there previously. And I'm going to update the recent transaction from our customer ID 1. So if you notice, customer ID was 578, and I'm doing another transaction, value of 100 for customer ID 1. So I've inserted a new customer and updated the existing one. Now, if you want to merge these two records, if you want to make these changes available in the customer account table, now you can use the merge command. And the merge command syntax looks something like this. So you could do, you can say merge your source table, which is the recent transaction. You want to merge into customer account from the recent transaction, and you want to update the balance. Essentially, you want to add the transaction value with the balance. And if it's not there, you want to insert it. So now let's look at the, after that merge is done, let's look at the table now. And now you see that customer ID value got updated. And for customer ID 10, which was not there, a simple insert was possible. So now I think it's a great addition here from the developer's perspective, making the merge very easy to write queries here. With that, I'm going to conclude my talk here. Thanks for listening. I know I was lost to consume here, but again, have a great day. Thank you. Mm-hmm.